Now, however, when we change the context from the public park to the shopping mall, then all of a sudden we never win, because that's a private space, right? So when we're moving from this internet, this original decentralized system that we used to have, that's being attacked by all these horrible laws, we're still fighting in a public space. When we move to social media monopolies, like Facebook, like YouTube, etc., we have no rights there at all. It's private property. Our rights there are simply based on the privileges granted by the operator, which means we can use the platform only in ways that benefit the operator, right? So if you look at, if you look at things like the DMCA, which is one of the first of the big draconian laws that came in, that came into fight perceived damages of piracy and stuff like that, of copyrighted material. If you look at the DMCA assumes a coercive relationship between the rights holder and the publisher. It assumes the situation where somebody has a website or something that is hosting some kind of copyrighted material, and the rights holder needs a coercive law that they can take to the courts to get to coerce this person to take it down, right? This still grants both parties rights, right? So even the DMCA, draconian as it is, still grants some rights to the publisher. The rights holder has to file a court order, and there has to be certain timeliness to it. The court order has to be filed within a certain amount of time, where the content goes back up. Because it's a public space, the rights are still going both ways. But now, because they're private spaces, places like YouTube, when the rights holder wants to take material down, they no longer need to go to the courts at all. They already have a relationship with the platform that came as a condition of their funding that allows them to simply take down whatever content they want. And when there's a dispute, the dispute is routed not to the courts, not to any third party, not even to the publisher themselves, but to the rights holder. So when you put something up on YouTube, for example, and it gets taken down, and then you complain about it, say, no, actually, I do have the rights to this, the person who actually decides whether or not that's true is actually the rights holder, not the platform, not you, not any judiciary. So in some ways, the centralization of social media, this privatization of this kind of online public space, has almost made these battles over the DMCA and SOPA and PIPA kind of irrelevant. Because we're talking about our rights in the public park, but our social space is no longer the public park. Our social space is now the shopping mall, in which the security guards have absolute and total power. And so when you're talking about privacy in this context, it comes back to what he was saying about privilege, right? I mean, privacy is ultimately a relationship, right? It's a relationship that we have with our society, right? And there might be advantages to me wanting other people to know certain things about me, and maybe even vendors that might be giving me better services. But it's a matter of control. And if this was a public sphere, maybe we could even have some control. We can fight over data retention laws, right? But when it gets moved to the private sphere, we lose all control, right? And one answer that people often have to this is, well, we just shouldn't use these Facebooks, these social media platforms. We should use, like, you know, Diaspora or Statusnet or X number of various other kind of alternative social media platforms, right? And in some cases, this is a valid point, and I certainly support efforts to develop those platforms. But in other cases, it's a fantasy. We're selling a fantasy. The reality is that our social capacity to build communication platforms has to work on a very, very large scale. And we need to have social processes that actually provide for the funding, sustenance, development of communication platforms. In the same ways we need it for roads and train systems. Social media platforms, communication platforms don't build themselves. They're expensive to build and operate. And to imagine that a few hackers can build something in their spare time that can function for the 6 billion people on the planet is strictly delusional. It's strictly delusional. It functions for us. I have no problem using it. Many people here use it. It can be our own kind of private side channel, but it's not. But if we're going to look at how the masses communicate, how society itself communicates, what our capacity for communication is, we have to ask these questions socially, and we have to ask: is capitalism, is private profit, the right model to build communication platforms? And until we ask that question, we can't really deal with surveillance or privacy.